Sinquefield Cup.
And here we are, round three of the Sinquefield Cup, live from St. Louis. I'm Jennifer Shahade. I'm with Grandmaster Yasser Seirawan. And today we have the matchup that everyone's been waiting for. We've got our tournament leader, our local hero, Hikaru Nakamura, facing Carlsen. Can't wait to see it. What do you think, Yas?
Absolutely. This is the big matchup and a rivalry I'm hoping will extend for another 10 years. One day, American chess fans want to see Hikaru playing Magnus for the World Championship. So this is a crucial game in their rivalry, as we know.
And let's see the recap from yesterday.
Oh, sure.
In today's game, world number one Magnus Carlsen battled against world number two Livon Aronian. It looked as though Carlsen had the upper hand throughout, but Aronian battled back and he was able to hold the young phenom to a steady draw.
Well, I just told myself I have no right to lose this.
In the other matchup, U.S. number one player Hikaru Nakamura played this fantastic move, queen to c5, against his main American rival, Gadakhmovsky, and with it was able to destroy his opponent and take a commanding 2-0 lead into tomorrow's contest against world number one Magnus Carlsen.
If I play good moves, I'll be fine. There's nothing more to it.
Now, Hikaru Nakamura is ranked number 5 in the world. He has defeated every one of the top 10 players on the planet, save one, and that is the guy he's playing today, Magnus Carlsen. In fact, he has a very shady record against Magnus, 0-7 in decisive games. If he's ever going to become world champion, he's going to have to stop that bleeding. As you see here, he's leading the tournament with two great wins. Magnus a half a point behind him, definitely wanting to overtake him now. And the two tail-enders, Livon Aronian and Gadakhmovsky, well, they're still in it. So they want to win as well. A victory today will bring them right back into the tournament. Jen, yes?
Now, we've been done pretty well with predicting openings in this tournament, but Carlsen Nakamura, it could be anything. I mean, Carlsen has beat Nakamura in so many different ways, right?
Right.
With almost every first move. I mean, he won against a nice Sicilian and a couple of Tata Steel games.
Yes, that was on January of this year, exactly.
And then more recently, he won with a 1c4. I mean,
right.
He's just a... really seems to be Nakamura no matter what poison he chooses.
Right. Very hard to predict Magnus's opening choice today. You know what, though? I'm going to surprise a little bit. I'm going to predict e4 for Magnus. And as we know,
I don't think so.
Yeah, okay.
But you've been right. I'm hoping you're right. Because every time you predicted e4, you've been right.
Yeah.
So.
And in the other game, Gadakhmovsky, as we know, started with two losses, but he had two blacks. So today he'll have white for the first time in the tournament, and he'll be looking to get back into this event. I was in Ningbo, China, when Gada played against Aronian with white, and Gada won. So
right.
He has good memories. And
do you think he'll play e4?
No, I don't think Gada's going to play e4. I think he'll go for d4.
Because they have similar repertoires
they
against
do.
e4.
They do.
So he'd be kind of like playing himself.
A little bit. But again, all of the players in this tournament are pretty universal, probably with the exception of Livon. Livon doesn't play e4 that often. He doesn't
SAE.
Oh, my SAE.
God. Look at that.
The sunglasses?
Nakamura is wearing sunglasses. You must have heard what we were saying yesterday. Maurice was saying that he's a terrible poker player.
Uh-huh.
That he's just too emo.
And I think...
And he is countering it with sunglasses. He knows that Carlsen is a tough opponent for him, so can't get a read on him in this game.
Wow.
Or less, let's just say less of a read.
Right.
Less of a read. Just, maybe he just wants to switch it up because you've had such a terrible record against Carlsen.
And
this
he
would
did
be so
play
massive
deep.
For you. And you were right again.
No, I was wrong.
Oh, you were wrong? I thought I saw the king pawn. I was wishful thinking there.
Me too. I saw d4.
And we do have a star-studded crowd here. I already see two... titled players right there in front of the audience. We've got Grandmaster Alejandro Ramirez, who's actually the runner-up in this year's U.S. Championship, taking a quick pick. And British journalist and WIM Sabrina Chavan.
Right, I see them in the audience. Yep.
And what opening is that? Is it going to be a NIMSO?
Or Grunfeld. I think G6 was played by Hikaru, just waiting for the relay moves to come through. But I did see on the webcam that D4, Knight F6, C4, and yes, I believe.
And Nakamura's also been known to play a King's Indian here and there.
Oh, absolutely.
He's had some fine victories with that, including a nice one, a beautiful one against Gelfand, right?
Yes. Oh, that was pretty. Also, he throws out the Dutch, so the opening move, Knight F6, had no Dutch today. We may be seeing a King's Indian, and that would be a full-body struggle. I'd look forward to that game very much.
Oh, yes. Just the fact that he's re-encountering the bishop, I think, means that we are going to see an exciting game, because either the Grunfeld or the King's Indian often lead to that kind of dynamic play that Nakamura excels at. This game also pivotal for him, not only because he's never beaten Magnus before, but also because if he wins this game, or even draws, he might catapult to his highest ever ranking in the world.
Right.
Number 4.
Right.
Right now he's a fraction of a point behind Grishuk.
Alexander Grishuk,
that's
yes.
That's right. So, and you know, I know Nakamura, he pretends that he doesn't care about that stuff, but
he does.
That's massive for him. He wants to be number 4 in the world, and that's closer to number 1.
Absolutely. So knight f3, and we are seeing a King's Indian. Very interesting. Bishop g7. Now, it's interesting to me that Magnus didn't play knight c3, but rather he went for a fianchetto system against a King's Indian of his own with g3. We did see the move castles by Hikaru, bishop g2, and now d6. So definitely no Grunfeld, and the players are heading towards a King's Indian. So knight c3. And in our other game, not too sure what's going on there yet. A queen pawn opening, it looks like. But c2, c3, hello. What on earth is Gata Kamsky doing? Confusing.
You mean that he's not playing ambitiously? Sometimes Gata does that, though.
Oh, yes.
I mean, he's done like certain like London types and systems and stuff in the past. Mm-hmm. He can play completely theoretical, or he can just really go off the beaten path. Now, we do have a graphic here to show Nakamura and Carlsen and how these two have fared in the past. We alluded to the fact that Nakamura has had a heck of a time. In fact,
he struggled. Yes.
Yes. I mean, just a brutal time. Even considering the rating differential, you would think he would have done a lot better.
Yes.
Losing 7 games, Magnus Carlsen winning 7 against Nakamura, and just an incredible record. But Nakamura is going to have to fix that eventually if he wants to make a race for the world championship. And he did mention in an interview that he sees Magnus as his main rival.
Absolutely.
So that's how he sees the world.
Right.
That he is going to be playing for that world championship at one point, and he needs to squash this.
Right.
Now, what do you make of the fact that the score is so bad? Do you think it's a psychological thing or a stylistic thing?
More stylistic. Normally, when you see a big differential between two elite players like that, it's just a stylistic matchup. And no question that Hikaru is going to have to make an adjustment. But Hikaru is so strong in the world of chess. Of course he should be considering Magnus as his main rival. Magnus is the number one rated player in the world, and that's what he should be aspiring to, is dethroning Magnus from that perch.
Now, he's not on the absolute throne yet. In terms of ratings, he is, but remember, he's playing Anand for the World Championship.
Absolutely.
In November. And, for instance, that's a player that Nakamura has had a much easier time with.
Right. Defeating the world champion is always a great feather in one's cap. And in their rivalry between Hikaru and Viswanathan Anand, it's not only that Hikaru has won games against the world champion, but he's all the games have been competitive. In this particular matchup between Magnus and Hikaru, a lot of the games have appeared at times extraordinarily one-sided, and that is a real big surprise.
That's right. Magnus has won some just beautiful games against Nakamura. And today, it looks like Nakamura is playing a kind of offshoot, knight c6 early variation of the King's Indian. Well, Magnus decided to go for the fianchetto variation rather than to go full-fledged into those, you know, main lines with e4 and knight e1 and whatnot.
Right.
So what do you think about this decision to play the fianchetto against the Kings in the end.
Yeah, actually, this has become more and more popular. G3 at one time was considered a slow play, and everybody, as white, usually played the E4 lines, as you mentioned, and playing for the big center. With the bishop on G2, white, king enjoys a lot more protection. And here is a big decision by Magnus. There's a long-winded variation. Hold on. Knight c6, castles. Okay, I'm just... All right, let me make my last move. Castles. And do we have a move by black? Oh, we have rook b8. All right. So this is a long-winded variation after... d5, knight a5. The knight looks a little bit out of the game over here on a5, but it does attack the c4 pawn. So knight d2, c5. And again, this gets into a very long-winded theoretical battle. And I noticed that Magnus did not play d5, but instead opted for bishop f4. Okay, just completing his development. Asking black how he's going to get this rook on b8 into play, or justify the move rook b8 rather. A6, rook c1, b5 is a very sharp line of play. And again, a6 was the choice of Hikaru. So again, rook c1. Now, whether they play b5 or not immediately, I'm not really too sure. They could, Hikaru could first preface the move b5 with the move bishop d7. From white's point of view, what white would like to do, if he can arrange that, is to play in the center with e4, e5, while black is playing on the queen side.
Now, Morozevich actually had this opening as well against Magnus. So Magnus Carlsen has played this before, so I'm sure Nakamura prepared for this variation.
Absolutely.
Obviously, you know, he plays a lot of different openings, so he's really well prepared in many of them. I am really curious about this issue of the sunglasses. He's just afraid that his terrible result against Magnus Carlsen maybe has something to do with Magnus reading his soul. trying to shield his eyes and make sure that he can't kind of get into Nakamura's head.
I do recall a famous story of the stare of Michael Tal. Former world champion Michael Tal was famous for his stare downs of his opponents. And one time Pal Benko came to the game with shaded sunglasses, mirrored glasses, in fact, so that Tal would be staring at himself. So maybe a page out of the historical past there with the sunglasses. By the way, I can't recall ever in my history playing against an opponent who wore sunglasses against me.
Well, I also play poker, so a lot of people play poker with sunglasses, but in chess it just seems like... very strange. I mean, I never wear them at all in any game because I find that it just makes the world look dimmer and it kind of diminishes my sharpness a little bit. And that's okay. So important in chess.
Of course.
I mean, so there could be an alternative explanation. I wouldn't be surprised if Nakamura comes down after the game and says something about allergy season. Now, whether that'll be a truthful answer or not is another question. But
exactly. And by the way, we do have rook c1 has been played. And here, the question for me is whether black plays bishop d7 or b5 or not. I think bishop d7 is the most common move in this position. Shall we just switch to our other board for a moment?
Let's take a look and see how this this London opening is going.
All right.
Has it turned into a London? No, in fact, it hasn't. You know, I thought that Kamsky... It has. Excuse me. So I thought that Kamsky was playing c3 with the idea of following it up thereafter with bishop f4, London system, which he's definitely played in the past with some success. So
exactly.
It's not a huge shock. The only reason it's a bit surprising is because he went for more sharp openings in his other games.
Indeed. D4, knight F6, knight F3, very normal. D5, as could be expected from Levon Aronian. Now, Levon is a real expert in these lines of the Slav, C4, C6, as well as the semi-Slav with E7, E6. And Gada decided he just didn't want to go into those reams of theory, and instead played extremely quiet move C3. I personally don't understand this particular move order. If, as white, I was going to play, as you describe it, the London system, I would just simply start with bishop F4. Anyway, it was the choice of Gada to play C3. C6. All right. Bishop F4 and knight H5. Immediately attacking the bishop on F4. Perfectly reasonable move from Black's point of view was to keep the symmetry alive with the move bishop F8. Levon didn't play that, as we saw. He simply played knight H5 and said, okay, I'm attacking your bishop. Where are you going to place it?
Because usually at some point white in the system will play H3 so that he can drop his bishop back to H2. So Levon trying to hit on the bishop before that happens.
As we saw, in fact, by Levon against Carlson yesterday, that H3 bishop H2 idea. It didn't work very well for Levon yesterday, and apparently Levon wasn't interested in allowing white to maintain his bishop, his dark square bishop, on the H2
diagonal. Oh my
god,
I thought you were suggesting bishop takes B8.
No.
That would make
bishop E3 has been played already.
Although it's funny, just bishop takes B8 just looks so counterintuitive. Somebody would have to pay you to play that move.
Exactly.
even in analysis,
yes.
It's painful because, of course, you like your bishops.
Exactly.
So bishop E3, kind of a strange looking move. I mean, normally you don't see this bishop in front of the pawn like that.
Exactly, because normally speaking, both players are aspiring to control the center, and it's in white's interest to be able to play e2, e4. On the other hand, this knight on h5 is not making a very good impression.
And here we have the history of these two players and how they faced off in the past.
One win, 5 losses, and lots of draws.
Yeah,
so a nice plus for Aronian in their head-to-head matchup.
That's right, and that's what you would expect. I think not such a massive result, but you would expect Aronian to have a plus score, much higher rated player.
Being the second highest rated player in the world, sure. All right, so after bishop E3, Aronian said, okay, what am I going to do with this bishop on F8? I'm going to fianchetto it. G6, G3 was played, bishop G7, bishop G2, castles, and both sides are happy. They have safe kings.
Now, if white had instead of played bishop e3 and dropped back with his bishop to g3, how would you assess that? Do you think that black would be happy just to snag the bishop?
Yes.
Even though we have that file.
Right. These double pawns are actually a plus for white in this specific position.
Right.
And this rook is now on the half-open h-file. So there's a compensation from white's point of view for having given away the two bishops, but I think black is very, very solid as well.
Do you think it's a quantifiable edge to have those two bishops?
Yes.
So when you mention the word compensation, it's like you got to have something. You can't just give up the bishop for no reason.
Precisely.
Yeah, that's right.
All right.
I think we have a Grandmaster Maurice Ashley who's going to chime in pretty soon with his thoughts on these openings. Again, not what we expected.
Not at all.
Indeed, some slow play so far, some play that looks solid. Not the kind of games we like to see coming out the gate. Obviously, they're very blocked positions, but we know that chess positions can blow up very quickly. Well, we talked about Carlsen's dominating record against Nakamura, and there are some games that are just classics, ones that Nakamura would love to simply forget. For example, is this game that he had at the Tata Steel Tournament back in 2011, and they got to this position we see here
It was all Carlsen all the way attacking down the board. And in this position, he sacrificed with the move. Bishop captures on h6. Let me play it here. Bishop takes h6. And after g takes h6, he pushed forward with g7, looking to open up all these lines to the king. If you capture back, you're just a sitting duck on the g7 square. So Nakamura played bishop to e7, trying to close lines. But after rook takes h6, now there was the threat of rook to h8, checkmate. The knight dropped back, attacking the rook. And what did Carlsen do? Ignore it. Queen to g6. Bringing his queen down, threatening another checkmate in one move on h7. The knight had to get rid of this rook, and now queen takes, and the blows just kept coming. Now queen to h8, mate is the threat. Bishop f6 trying to somehow placate the gods by giving away stuff, but Carlsen wasn't having any of it. He played queen h8 check, king f7 force, g8 queens, giving away his queen to be sure. Yes, but after queen takes f6 check, the king had to drop to e8. And rook e1 check, and that was all she wrote. Nakamura had to resign, because if king to d7, then simply rook to e7 check and king over, and any disco will work. Moving the rook out of the way, for example, a simple one like here, king here, and then queen to e7 would be mate. So a devastating, this kind of victory is the one that makes us all wonder, will Nakamura recover from these kind of body blows that Carlsen has been dropping on him? He has evolved as a player. We're looking to see if he can hold back his vicious opponent today and maybe start to show us that he's a real contender for the world title.
Jenny asks.
Thank you, Maurice. Yeah, definitely one of my favorite Carlsen victories over Nakamura, although he won another white Sicilian this year in Tata Steel, right?
Right, so that was a positional grind, whereas that one that Maurice just showed was a tactical melee, a beauty. I was there for both of those games, by the way.
And astonishingly, despite having that horrible game against Carlsen, that was Nakamura's best result he's ever had. The one in 2011.
The one he won. Yes.
He won the tournament. With that sole loss against Carlsen, marring the tournament slightly for him. But
exactly.
Just fabulous. And, you know, the only thing I could say is maybe this tournament could rival that for being his best tournament ever.
Well, certainly it's gone his way so far. Two wins in a row and gaining ranking and rating points. In the game, still quiet. The last moves, we had expected... after a6, rook c1, I had expected bishop d7. Hikaru first played the move h7, h6. As we're about to see in the game between Kamsky and Livon, in this position, white had the idea of playing queen d2, bishop h6, as did Gada Kamsky, in order to trade off this defender of the black king on g7. And that was why we understand Hikaru's move h7, h6, so that in case of queen d2, black could play king h7 and stop white's bishop from penetrating on the king side with bishop h6. So a kind of a defensive play, and still Magnus is going to have to answer the question of how does he strengthen his position. He played a very quiet move, b2, b3, saying to Hikaru, okay, just tell me what you're doing with your queenside initiative. Hikaru cannot play b5 at once, because what we're about to see is that this knight on c6 is left hanging after knight takes b5, rook takes b5, rook takes c6, winning a pawn for the good.
That's right, and that pawn now being on b3 doesn't allow black to equalize the material.
With rook takes b2. There is no rook takes b2 at the end. Exactly. So with this move b3, then the question goes right back to white. Okay, if black stops and plays the move bishop d7, protecting the knight, how is white intending to stop black's queenside advance, b5. Will he ignore it with a central advance of his own? For example, rook e1, b5, either capture. Let's just toss out the move e4. Now we see white having a broad array of pawns in the center of the board, giving him a serious space advantage. But at the moment, there are no particular weaknesses in Black's position. So very difficult strategical game in store in this position.
But definitely, definitely a comfortable opening for White. Not that I have anything wrong with Black's treatment, but in some of the games, we've just been thinking Black has done a fantastic job in the opening, like yesterday with Magnus Carlsen playing the Dutch against Levon, getting equality plus so early on. In this case, Nakamura is, as he should be with Black, on the struggling side.
Yeah, slightly worse. He has a space disadvantage, but again, no serious targets in Black's position, so I think both players are happy with the outcome in this case.
What are they playing for?
First place.
Big money at stake these guys who are in the lead so far at the Sinquefield Cup, the strongest tournament in history. First place, we've got $70,000, a nice chunk of change. And in second, the player will get $50,000, $30,000 for third, and $20,000 for fourth. So just by coming out here, they get $20,000 guaranteed. And considering all the work they put into this game, these prizes are very fitting. And it's a credit to all the things that the St. Louis Chess Club has done.
Oh, I totally agree with that. Wonderful to see an elite event of, I mean, the most strongest tournament in history in the United States, at least. And I was just thinking there for a moment about the strongest tournaments in history. That is to say, events with more than two players. And I'm guessing Avro, the World Championship. That might be the strongest tournament, elite tournament ever, but certainly the strongest on U.S. soil.
Right. It's a very exciting. If you guys have any questions or comments, use the hashtag SinqCup, S-I-N-Q Cup, and you can also email us at questions@stlouischessclub.com.
Exactly.
So we got a lot of great questions yesterday, comments, from even some strong grandmasters and international masters.
Nigel Short.
It's exciting to hear from all of you.
Exactly.
Yeah, and I think we're going to get Nigel on later today as well.
So oh, lovely.
That's something to stay tuned for, getting the always opinionated grandmaster Nigel Short's thought on these games.
Let's just see. We'll check back in with U.S. champion Gata Kamsky for a moment. Gata had played this move, Queen C1, and I noticed setting up for this a strategic operation of trading this bishop on e3 for this bishop on g7. Knight d7, bishop h6, rook e8. Black aspires to open things up in the center with e5. And due to the quiet play thus far, I think Black has actually equalized already at this moment. I don't see this position as offering White any particular advantage. I think one of the things that Gata might be thinking is, look, I started with two losses. Why don't I just simply stop the bleeding?
Right, stopping the bleeding. Well, Maurice Ashley, what do you think about all that?
Well, you see a quiet game between the two players, and maybe, as you said, Kamsky is comfortable with the draw. But in the contest these guys have had, they've always been long, drawn-out battles. In fact, the last few games they had with Aronian with the black pieces, the decisive games ended in 72 moves, one game, and the other two in 80 moves. So if they're going to play for a victory, it's going to take some time. Colleagues, we might be here all day the way they play. But one of the games was a wild affair. Despite the fact that it took that long to play out, this position they had in the World Team Championship in Ningbo, China. I think you were there, Yaz, on that team for the United States. And in this position, you see it's crazy. I mean, look at the kings. The pawns are nuts. And in this position, Aronian played the move e4, attacking the white queen, and then queen e3, and saw his rook kind of funny, trapped in this position, and he sacked an exchange here. And after takes, queen takes pawn, rook to e1, attacking that e-pawn, Black played rook e8, and Kamsky hit back with rook takes f3. Obviously, there's this pin on the e-file, but Aronian countered with bishop e5 check, closing the pin on the file. So just craziness, rook to g3, and now queen takes pawn. Obviously, rook takes queen's impossible because of the pin to the king. King g2, and so Aronian won back the exchange. And now you see it's 5 against 5. It looks like it was fine for black, except in just a couple of moves after king g8, rook f1, rook f8, this trade, king takes on f8, queen f4 check, Kamsky was able to swing his king closer to that pawn on e4, and very shortly, he was able to actually win this pawn after the king maneuvered, and he took this pawn, and the game continued with check, king h8, queen h8 check, king c7, and now queen takes on h5. So you see, he had a pawn up. He went on to get a winning position in the end game. We jump ahead. We see he had 2 extra pawns in the end game, and Aronian had to resign. So just wild chess they have played before, but it takes a little time. It takes a little time. Slow but sure. So we'll be sure to see some action in this game, at least we hope to, between the two tail enders in the tournament. Back to you, Jen and Yas.
No guarantees about that, but definitely an amazing win by Gata against such a strong player. And, you know, I know that tournament was a big one for you, too. You did fantastically in that event.
Sure. And actually, it was a real highlight of the world team is we had great team spirit in Ningbo. And after the games, all the grandmasters would show their games. And Gata was especially forthcoming in his victory over Aroni in a crucial, crucial match between the U.S. and Armenia. And Gata was, he demonstrated that he was in complete control all the way in that game. And it belies their individual tournament results with one another, where Livon has a big edge. And Gata just imperially showed that he was ready to win that game, and he did.
Now, we have Livon Aronian on the camera right now. It looks like he took some dressing tips from us, pink and gray.
You're in pink, I'm in gray, and Livon's our combination.
Yeah, these are a colorful bunch. You know, it's nice to see some interest in fashion by chess players. You know, there's that massive show coming to the World Hall of Fame in October. It's going to be their biggest show yet about Alexander McQueen, chess and fashion. So you guys should consider coming out to that. Now, another big event that's coming there, which your colleague, International Master John Donaldson, has something to do with, is a show on Piatigorsky.
Jacqueline Piatigorsky, a very, very important sponsor of chess in the 60s, 50s, 60s, and 70s. She passed away recently. She was close to 100 years old, but she was a big chess fan, played in the U.S. Women's Championships, and always enjoyed chess, supported a lot of chess and schools in Los Angeles programs.
And one of the reasons why we're having this exhibition now is because we have the Sinquefield Cup,
right.
And she had the main psychic tournament, Piatigorsky Cup, where you had Tigran Petrosian playing in some event.
And Boris Basky, Bobby Fischer,
of course. So, really nice to kind of bring back that whole cup idea and elite chess to the United States.
Let me just continue with the game between Gata Kamsky and Aronian for a moment. Knight takes e5, rook takes e5. Now you notice that this rook attacks the pawn on e2. Gata played e2, e3, and from black's point of view, this knight on h5 has done its job already, and Livon brought his knight back into the game with knight f6. And again, a very even-looking position at the moment. As we see, white's pieces are not intimidating anybody, all on the first rank. So Gata played the move knight d2, ideas of c4, and maybe swinging this knight back into the center with knight f3 to d4. I think that this is a very tame position, and no advantage for either side at this moment.
Right, but you never know. Sometimes these things can get exciting out of nowhere.
Very, very quickly.
We'll always keep our eyes on it. Now let's, for those of you who are tuning in and you know, getting excited as we reach the midway point of the Sinquefield Cup, let's talk about the players.
My name is Gata Kamsky. I'm from New York City. I'm the current U.S. chess champion.
I'm Hikaru Nakamura. I'm from St. Louis, Missouri, and I'm the number one ranked chess player in the U.S.
I'm Livon Aronian. I'm from Armenia, and I'm number two ranked player in the world.
I'm Magnus Carlsen. I'm from Norway, and I'm ranked as number one in the world.
You know, we're trying to promote our game, so I think everybody knows that it's the first tournament of such kind in the United States for a long time. So I think everybody is going to do their best. Everybody is going to try to entertain the public and play combative chess.
And it's very prestigious. And of course, it's the honor of the United States at stake. So we have to perform well.
So the popularity of chess in certain places is very high. But for me, it's all about America. And for whatever reason, it doesn't seem like there's the level of popularity at the moment. And I'm just hoping that whether it's me, whether it's Kamsky, whether it's players like Carlson or Aronian, that in some way we can raise the profile.
I think chess has the appeal of something interesting, something deep, and that's our advantage. And I think that's going to attract people of America.
It's really quite nice to see that there is an elite tournament here.
And again, this tournament is the first among many firsts that the organizers created here in St. Louis. The St. Louis is the chess capital of the U.S. It's only fitting that you guys have here the best tournament.
Actually, I can call myself a representative of the capital of chess, Yerevan, because we have so many clubs and so many people. But I feel tension because I feel that the city of St. Louis is slowly trying to compete with us.
I know that the U.S. Championship has been here for a few years. I've been following it online, both the games and the commentary, and I've heard only positive things about it, and that's part of the reason why I was eager to come here myself.
I think I would have said I'm looking forward to playing Carlson the most. We've played many times before, and most people know I don't have a good score against him, so it's a chance to kind of change things, and I'm just going to do my best.
Yeah, I played Kamsky twice in the World Cup, 2005, 2007. He's extremely tough, fights till the end every time, and I think I have some of the same qualities, and that's why our games are usually quite interesting.
Every player in the world has a unique style, and Livon is one of the most original players you can ever meet. You know, his understanding of chess, his personality, they're all very unique.
I think my usual something adventurous on the borders of something crazy.
Obviously, I enter every tournament with a mindset that if everything goes according to plan, I should have a very good chance of winning.
You know, I'm going to do really well. That's what I feel, but I don't know how well.
I just only play for honor, for glory, and, you know, for chess, for the sake of chess.
It will definitely not be easy, and I look forward to it.
We all know each other for many years now, played each other so many games. So it'll be intense, it'll be interesting, and hopefully the fans will be glad.
And we're back. Round 3 of the Sinquefield Cup. Nakamura Carlson. Actually, rather, Carlson Nakamura. And Nakamura has just played a move.
Wow.
That has upset your positional instincts, hasn't it?
Yes and no. G6, G5, extremely aggressive play by Hikaru. I had thought that the move H7, H6 was defensive in nature just to prevent white from playing that queen to D2 to bishop H6 maneuver. But Hikaru has taken the move H6 a step further and has boldly played G5. My goodness, that is a move you don't see often, because the whole point is, as we see here, white's king enjoys a nice pawn shield, and it's very rare for players to throw pawns in front of their kings forward. But in this case, there's a concrete idea. Black does attack white's dark square bishop, and I think Hikaru wants to follow it up with the move knight g4, trying to double white's pawns, as we see here for a moment. After queen d2, knight takes e3, queen takes e3, then in this case, the only defender of this pawn on d4 is the knight on f3. And here we see the pawn going forward once again, g5, g4, attacking the knight. If the knight were to move out of the way, then bang, knight takes d4, and black wins a pawn. So we'll have to go back. This is a very forcing variation. I don't see how Magnus can avoid it.
Well, because we'd like to get in the in-between move at some moment in d5, but it always seems to lose a pawn or worse. Like, if we do it here, it loses a pawn.
Right. If we play d5 at once, then black will obviously take the bishop, and after taking the knight, he could take this pawn with the threat of capturing on either f2 or h2 with a check. After the recapture, pawn takes knight d4. You could win that pawn back, Jen, and maybe that's white's best choice, in fact, is to do something of this nature.
Right, because you're threatening not only to capture the pawn, but you're also threatening the square c6, forking the queen and the rook. So c5 will be insufficient here.
Right, that would actually cost black an entire rook, because the rook and queen are simultaneously attacked by the knight.
Although maybe instead of taking on g3, what else could black have tried? Let's take that back a little bit. So here, I wonder about just taking on c6 immediately.
Although, that change anything?
No, I mean, again, you don't have to take on f4, though. You can simply just play knight b4 instead.
Mm-hmm.
It seems like a superior choice.
Exactly.
Okay, one more idea, though. Maybe just like maybe playing e5 instead of playing take on c6. How's that look? No, we're not up material there. But
right, exactly. Then you're not in.
Yeah, that doesn't look hot at all.
Well, after you played e5, you have weakened the square, control of the square f5. So after, for example, takes, either white, I would probably capture on f4, although white might jump immediately all over this f5 square,
yeah,
with the move knight
and
h4.
And our bishop g7 being very
a little
powerless.
Passive,
yeah.
A little passive. Here.
That's a problem when you make a move like e5, you're also blocking your bishop.
All right, but we'll go back for a moment. Again, just to complete the thought, after g5, bishop e3, let us just say knight here, queen d2, white could recapture with this pawn on e3, and that's a compromised pawn structure, all right, no question about that. But on the other hand, black may not be all that happy about having advanced his own kingside pawn shield as well. So I suspect that black is doing well here.
Yeah.
So
maybe he'll go for the d5 line. Because, you know, note that once you play knight g4, d5 is no longer effective because knight takes e3 also hits the rook on f1.
Right.
So the time to play d5 is immediately, and that's probably why Carlsen is thinking in this position rather than just pushing his bishop backwards.
Right. I don't think it works at all, but I always like looking at these types of sacrifices,
yeah,
of the pieces.
It.
You know, just... You know, you're not, unfortunately, from White's point of view, his queen isn't over here on the king, somewhere over on the king side. So this attack is not going to be worth a piece. But you do look at these types of things anyway.
One of my favorite tweets so far we got today was from Mark Twick, and he has a picture of Paul Benko playing with sunglasses against Mikhail Paul.
Mark Crowder of Twick?
This is a kind of towel-like thing that...
I had to see the photo as well. It's great. That's a great historical photo. Shout out to Mark. Thank you. Yes, so this sacrifice isn't going to work. So what would you do, Jen? You're saying you would play for d5?
I think I would go for d5 just because it... Your bishop e3, knight g4 just looks so sufficient for black. And this
all right.
Whereas we haven't found anything that's that great for black yet, have we?
Well,
we kind of liked white in a lot of the positions.
Well,
so, and I think Grandmaster actually agrees and might have some thoughts on it as well. So
all right.
We'll move to him and get his thoughts on this committal move, g5.
Okay.
Yay or nay?
Well, looking at this position with the computer, it actually thought that white was doing really well anyway. It had white at a slight edge in the position, and so the move g5, it actually considered it as one of its top moves, if not the first one. Rook e8 was the other one, and so g5 looked like a natural move for the computer anyway. It looked crazy to my eyes at first. And looking at it now, I really feel like white's going to end up being the better for it, although he's given up his bishop for the knight. This is actually how the game has proceeded. Carlsen did play d5. Nakamura captured on f4, and then pawn takes on c6. So the little weakness on the king side, that'll be a long-term weakness, something that Nakamura will never be able to fix, but he's hoping that he can compensate with this bishop on g7. I got to say, it looks a little bit shaky to me, but an aggressive player like Nakamura is comfortable in these kind of random positions. And even Carlsen himself has said that he's avoided some lines because Nakamura likes chaos. So we'll see how it goes. Back to you, Jen and Yas.
Thank you, Maurice.
Thank you, Maurice. Interesting that the computer did like the move g5. I mean, I was taken aback by that move. I thought that it was overly aggressive. But if this was the best that White can do, I can understand why Hikaru essayed it.
Yeah, that's right.
I'm looking at after takes. Now, perhaps I shouldn't be capturing this pawn on c6, but imagine that Black were to play a move like b7, b6. So this pawn on c6 is a really a kind of a bone in Black's throat. But from Black's point of view, he does have the two bishops. At the moment, his king is fairly safe. And we can see that once Black plays moves like bishop c8 to g4 or bishop c8 to f5 and drops back with his bishop to g6, he does have fairly good control in the center. And this bishop on g2 is not really great on that diagonal. It's a great bishop in terms of defending the king, but not such a powerful attacking bishop.
But that pawn could become powerful if he can, protect it with another pawn, crack open the queen side in some way. So I'm still kind of preferring White, especially I think that this kind of position will suit Carlsen's like creative style, where it's a bizarre pawn structure that we've never seen before.
Yeah.
I think this will be up Carlsen's alley. Not that it's not up Naka's as well, but I still like White, although you think your move b6 is certainly a major improvement over taking on c6, which looked a little bit rotten.
Well,
now we have a tweet actually coming in. We got lots of tweets coming into our hashtag SyncCup, and this one is one of my favorites so far. Of course, we like when people say nice things about us.
Sure.
Thank you, Peter Warren, who says that thanks for the fantastic coverage. Chess is now a live game, not something you read about a week later. That's right. Chess and the web are just so well suited to each other because
Indeed.
We can watch it, all the action live, and look up stats on our opponents and all that. I mean, look up stats on the players as they are playing the game. Study the position, learn, and be entertained at the same time.
And just have that multimedia ability of interfacing with the audience, answering your questions, having guest grandmasters and commentators coming on and telling us what's going on. It's great. The internet is perfect for
chess. Yes. I mean, I did misspeak a little bit there when I said during the game. I was like, no. Computers and chess are not well suited for actual competitive chess, because of course that's one of the issues that leads to potential cheating.
Oh, sure.
And we hear about these scandals from time to time. Luckily, most chess players are quite honorable.
Yes.
And the restrictions on allowing cheating are getting better and better.
Right.
But, like, for instance, in this tournament, any major tournament that occurs at the St. Louis Chess Club, all of the electronic devices are collected
in the
first floor.
That's right.
It's becoming more of the industry standard.
Sure. And everybody's scanned. And the reality is when you look at the playing hall and you see just how many people are hovering around, spectators, arbiters, players are absolutely no chance whatsoever of getting inside information. Nobody's going up and whispering, my computer recommends this move, or anything of that sort.
No, not that you would ever see it on this level anyway.
No.
But you have seen some incidents all across the board, just because it's unfortunately rather easy to do in
There's
some
a temptation.
Tournaments. That's
it's
right.
Sad to say, there is a temptation. But I really think in the world of chess, at the elite level, pardon me, let me qualify myself, the elite level, no. Unfortunately, at amateur levels where, there might be a $5,000 class prize or something like that, and the tournament, the computer makes such a big impact on the players, unfortunately, the temptation is there. But it's super well controlled here.
That's right. So, we've had Nakamura is still sporting the sunglasses. I think, Nakamura is just like such a proud guy.
Yeah.
He's got a, he's, he's got this great personality, but he's also too proud, I think, to take them off. Even if he's uncomfortable with them, I don't think he's going to take them off.
That's what I was, what was going through my mind as well. I mean, we all have our, let's say, rituals at the board and how we approach the game and just, in fact, how we move the pieces. And the idea is wearing a pair of sunglasses myself, I mean, that would really alter my perspective of the chessboard. And I think I personally would find it very uncomfortable to do that. Hikaru, as I know, as far as I know, pardon me, is wearing them for the first time.
Yeah, Ray-Bans, so, I think.
Right. So would you really do something unique in the biggest event of your life?
Well, the biggest event, I mean, it's one of the biggest. One of the biggest on his home stage, yeah. I mean, maybe it's just the beautiful natural lighting here at the St. Louis Chess Club. I mean, that's one of my favorite things about the club, that as on those top floors, you've got beautiful light streaming in. And
that's right.
It's wonderful, but maybe he's not quite used to that. So that could be another explanation.
We'll have to wait.
Yeah, we're going to be curious to hear what he has to say about that.
Right.
And speaking of which, everybody should come out and visit in person. It's a fantastic event, and there's lots of other events if you don't get a chance to come out for the Sinquefield Cup.
Let me just bring our attention once more back to the game at hand between Hikaru. Hikaru's on move, and he's been thinking about there are two captures that he could make. The first one on c6, the second one on g3. I think I would go for this capture on g3, and let's just look at this for a moment, because we had, I'm just not sure how big or the advantage or disadvantage for either player may be in this very forcing line. Takes on g3, h to hg3, takes on c6. The benefit of that is at least the rook is on the half-open b-file. Knight to d4, aspiring to win back the pawn on c6. Bishop to d7, knight takes c6, I'm assuming. Bishop takes c6, bishop takes c6. So in this resulting middle game position, it's bishops of opposite color. This pawn on h6 is a little bit of a sore thumb. Black would like to scoot it over to g6, but that's illegal against the rules. But after, for example, a move like e7, e6, controlling the d5 square, only because of the structure, I would give white an edge. I just don't know if it's that big an advantage. It feels like white should have the edge, but it may not. It may just simply be optical, is what I'm trying to say. It's not like this knight on c3 has any great squares to hop to. And in the meanwhile, black is ready to play moves like queen e7, perhaps rook b6, and one day c5, gaining some squares in the center. So I don't think this is that bad a choice for black.
Although Carlson has squeezed juice from a lot less.
Yes, it's true. And then, again, if Hikaru is in a more aggressive mood, he may just allow this pawn on c6 to stay there and play this move b7, b6, and say, okay, what do you got? Let me just make a move. What do you think about this one, Jen? Knight d4, bishop g, knight d4, bishop g4. If we continue for white with a move like queen d3,
you're eyeing that square.
Yeah, I'm really eyeing that square.
And one thing I like about that too is if we try to protect that square with something like queen c8, you might have a timely knight d5, which it's not really something you're going to want to do to take on d5 and allow that beautiful protection of my pawn on c6.
That's true. But the idea behind bishop g4 was to only after the bishop is outside of the pawn chain, then to play the move e7, e6. And as you just pointed out, this move e6 would protect both the d5 square as well as the f5 square. And in this particular position, after the move e7, e6, I think black is doing all right here as well. Again, I don't like this pawn on h6, but after bishop back to h5 and g6, black's king is going to be ultra solid behind these two bishops on g6 and g7. If he can get all of that in, I like I'll take Hikaru's
position.
Yes,
I do like your plan of playing bishop g4 and e6, and maybe there's something
we'll have to go
more
back
pressing
a bit.
Than queen d3.
Okay.
It doesn't look too hot to play queen d3 after that. Knight g4, bishop g4.
You like the initial move, knight d4?
Yeah, but
it looks okay to me, too.
Now, I don't like it from a positional point of view. I guess, so if I play f3, you're just going to go back to c8. Is that the idea, after inducing the weakness?
No, I'll put my bishop
and
back
then,
here.
And then you don't really fear me hopping into f5.
Oh, for sure. You could do that. And you could take away one of my best defenders, that bishop on g7. But, okay, at the same time, you've kind of buried your own bishop here for a moment.
True. Although maybe I'll try to play for e4 and f4.
Sure. This type of business, let's say. Yes?
Yeah.
Something like
and
this.
And at least white here is retaining the edge, whereas in the other line with
it was questionable.
E6, bishop h5, g6, that didn't look good at all.
Right. It was questionable for you. Yeah.
So, I do find this position will be suited to Magnus's style. So even though Nakamura has played well so far, the game is going to go on for quite a while.
Oh, without question, the two great fighters here we're talking about, yes.
And we have some thoughts from Grandmaster Maurice Ashley on the progress of our big game today so far.
Indeed, Jen, this position Nakamura is playing is very creative. We know his style is very creative. My only worry is that it might be easier for white to play this position. You know, you have those kind of positions where it's equal. It's definitely both sides have their chances, but one side finds the position easier to play. And you give a guy like Carlson the position with white, it's just super easy. He knows what kind of ideas to play, and it won't be that difficult for him to start pressing the position, even if Nakamura is okay. By the way, the programs think that Nakamura is slightly worse, but not by that much. So it seems that he should be able to manage the position, but long term, it just might be more difficult for him to handle and maybe make some tricky decisions along the way. Remember, it's easy for us because we're analyzing the position with no pressure whatsoever, and he's facing the number one player in the world. That said, we have seen Nakamura do some miracles in chess, and I'd like to show you this one game he played that was one of his finest games he ever played. He did this 6 years ago in Barcelona. He played this game against Mikhail Krasinkov, who was a 2668 grandmaster at the time. And in this position, Krasinkov thought he had a really nice idea, and he played the move knight to c6. And the idea behind this move, which looks like it loses two pieces for the rook after rook takes knight, was to play this discovered attack, bishop takes knight here, but the rook now attacking the queen, and it looked to all rights that he was going to be able now to take this rook and definitely win an exchange, except Nakamura shocked him with the hyper-brilliant queen takes f2 check, giving away his queen. What a surprising move that was for Krasinkov to see. And after king takes queen, bishop not taking anything, c5 check, and suddenly this king was caught in a crossfire of black pieces. He couldn't retreat to f1 in this variation because of c3 check, another bishop showing up. And the idea being that if rook to e2, then this brilliant move, c2, four king, queen, and rook, and if you take, then suddenly this could happen. And then after the king moves, bishop drops back with another check to the king, hitting the queen, just totally lights out. By the way, he could have taken an f6, all kinds of nastiness. If we jump back to this moment when he played the move, bishop to c5 check, the king went up the board instead, but it ran into some vicious black pieces as it went. Knight e5 check, king to g5, rook g6 check, king to h5, and then the quiet, beautiful move, f6. Threatening rook to h6 mate. The king has nowhere to go. Desperation time was rook takes e5, and after rook takes with check, king to h4, and then the final blow, bishop dropping back to c8, completely caging the king, and no answer to the mate threat coming on h6. Something like g4 would have been met by bishop f2 check, king back, and then rook to h6 mate. So one of those brilliant, brilliant games of Nakamura that we have seen over the years that just shows that this guy is absolutely world-class and deserves to be among the world elite. His main challenge, though, is beating this guy in front of him because, as we've said, he's defeated everyone else. It's just this one dude who's holding him up. Back to you, Jen and Yaz.
That's right. Not just any dude, though.
And world's number one. And what's the expression? Some positions are more equal than others.
Oh, no.
Okay. But we have seen H takes G3 by Hikaru. And very... F takes G3, pardon me. And very quickly, Magnus did respond H2 takes G3. So they're catching up with us. While Maurice was giving his insights, and that was a... Wow, that was a really brilliant example of Hikaru's tactical flair. Here's one. I know Maurice said that the computer favors White's position. Here's one. Let's say I'm in hyper-aggressive mode. How about this move, instead of B7, B6, how about B7, B5, putting pressure on White for a moment? What do you think, Jen? Would you capture on B5?
Sure, let's try capturing.
Sure, why not, right? Takes. Now, Black's idea in this position is he wants, if he can, with B4?
Or, I mean, probably B4, yeah.
Yeah, B4.
I just think that pawn looks too weak.
Right, exactly. So, I mean, it's a very bold play. So the idea is that you want to play knight D4 and capture this pawn, but as Jen just said, she'd like to fix the pawn for a moment so that it can't go anywhere after B4.
Let's get up to date on this board. I think we've seen some more moves.
Oh, I have
Some structures that I think we predicted earlier actually have occurred on the board.
All right. Pardon me. Mm-hmm. I'll bring the game back into my window viewer for a second. All right. So we have the game. I'm not sure if on our graphic screen it's caught up with my analysis board, but we were just looking at this move B7, B5, and it hasn't flipped over, so we seem to be frozen for just a little bit of a moment over here.
Yeah, we'll get the current position up with you ASAP, but in the meantime, yeah, I like your point about that... that move just being too weakening, and it looks like instead Nakamura has played another suggestion of yours and ended up putting that pawn on B6 as well.
He did. He went.
Which is a much superior move in that it doesn't create that massive weakness.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay.
And
so
we have actually the world rankings that we want to review as we watch the world's best play here in St. Louis.
All right.
And as we know, we've mentioned before, Magnus Carlsen, number one. Aronian, number two. Now, he might lose that spot if he doesn't get his act together in this tournament.
Yes, he's dropped 15 rating points so far in this event due to those two results in rounds one and two. Sorry, Jen, continue.
So, yeah, that's right. So Kramnik could leapfrog over him if he's not too careful in this tournament. And then Nakamura in ninth place in the official FIDE rankings, but in the world... live ratings, which didn't take into account this tournament as well.
Right.
He's racing up based on this tournament and could even be number four at the end of this game.
Right.
That's huge. Going from 9 to 4. Incredible. Let's see if he does it. And Gata Kamsky in 16th place right now. So,
right now.
It's and a pretty star-studded field there. Now, I wonder if a draw in this game will be enough for Nakamura to get into fourth. I guess it'll be rather close. Yeah, you'd think so, because it's only 1 point away, right?
Well, draw, yes.
Yeah.
But draw or not, I mean, as we say, Magnus has been a riddle for Hikaru that he has not solved. So even if he gets up to fourth or third or something like that, I mean, 1 point one day in his career, he's going to have to solve the Magnus Carlsen. And my goodness... there he did it. He went for B5.
Okay, so he has played B5. I guess we were a little confused there. We thought maybe that he had played B6, but it doesn't look like he played both modes. Huh. Quite interesting. So let's see if we're up to date here with our main
board. So this is definitely the most aggressive move in the position for Black, is to play this move B5. And the line we were about to look at was takes. We can't move the well. We could move the knight here immediately,
yeah, that's another
but that doesn't game. That doesn't stop Black from advancing his pawn with B5, B4.
And that doesn't cut too impressively because that pawn is well protected by the rook, and also now A2 is a weakness that we can hammer on, and we can get our bishop to A6. So lots of nice aggressive possibilities that didn't exist before we pushed that pawn forward. That's why we thought fixing the pawn in one way before seeming the most obvious
right.
would be the right play here, trying to get knight d4 in next, perhaps.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what does Nakamura have in mind here? Because at first glance, this just looks quite pleasant for white, doesn't it?
Well, yes, it does. This, optically, it looks very nice. White wants to go knight here, and knight d4 takes b5. But let me give you a different approach to the position for a moment. Imagine that white made two consecutive moves. Knight f3 to d4 takes b5. So now you've moved your knight across the board, and your knight on f3 is actually a pretty darn good defender of your king. Imagine black said, okay, I'm going to sacrifice a pawn. Just go ahead and win the pawn. I'll go bishop here.
So unlike you, Yasser. Yeah. What happened to your materialism?
Well, I'm advocating here for a moment for Hikaru's play. Knight to d4, e5.
E5, okay, yeah.
Go ahead and take my pawn.
I would think you might play that, all right.
Knight takes pawn. So now your knights are, shall we say, kind of frozen together for a moment, okay?
Rex Sinquefield, the founder here, likes to call them codependent.
Codependent, I like that. Okay, I'm gonna steal that as an original thought. Codependent.
Yeah, more fun than Dvoretsky's superfluous, right?
Exactly, codependent. Okay, so now your knights are fixed for a moment, and maybe while the knights are over here doing nothing, I can either play d5, playing for an edge in the center with d5, d4, or how's this for turning this turnip into a battering ram, h5, to try to get some action going over here on the king side.
Yeah, that's possible, but I think I like your other idea better, a d5.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, h5, I wonder, I mean, we saw Magnus's fantastic defensive skills against Gata. Do you really think this is going to be enough for a pawn after a4? Maybe preparing knight d5 and trying to trade and hammer on c7?
Well, let's have a look-see. Yeah. So, I mean, it's a very sharp pawn sacrifice already by Hikaru. Here he's going for a second pawn sacrifice. But you're right. I mean, Magnus is a consummate defensive player. He can find the moves he needs to. But here, I think black is putting white under a lot of pressure.
And if I play just like knight d5 here, oh, well, I'm hanging on e2 actually a little bit. I don't know if I want to do that. I'm trying to trade off some pieces, but I don't like the fact that after knight d5, queen d5, e2 hangs. And, well, if knight d5, bishop d5, I'm removing my last defender. Not that's necessarily the end of the world.
Well, the king is getting a lot of exposure suddenly, isn't it?
Not in a good way.
Not
all
in a good way.
Not good publicity.
And those shades, my goodness, there's some sunshine there.
I think Maurice has some thoughts on this. Would this pawn sacrifice be legit for Nakamura?
Well, it's an interesting position. First he played g5, and now he's played b5. You don't see that every day. Typical Nakamura creativity. Now, one of the things about Magnus that we were really inspired and amazed by was the way he could play what seemed like the computer's first move. You remember that game that he played against Kamsky where he played these amazing defensive moves. And when he looked at the computer said, yeah, that's right, that's how you should play. And they were stunning moves to natural human eyes and to the average grandmaster, yours and myself included. But this time, he played a move that the computer completely rejects. And that is this capture that he just played in the game, C takes on B5. The computer, in fact, I've been analyzing with it, and it shows me its first choice, second, all the way down to its seventh choice, seven tries down, and it still doesn't show C takes B5 as a good option. It's not until I get to the eighth try, in fact, right now at the eighth try, does C takes B5 appear as a move for white. So it did not like the exchange at all on B5. It thought the best move was a very solid queen to D3, not trading. And then after pawn takes here, and by the way, putting pressure on that pawn, after pawn takes back and look to get on this square D5 with a knight. In the event of takes and the move, you guys have been suggesting the move B4. It thinks just simply E5, stopping the knight from going to D4, and The pawn's not a problem, and it will play for that same kind of play that you're talking about, Yaz. So maybe Carlsen didn't play the most accurate move, at least to the silicon eyes. And now we see he's stopped to look at the board. Well, actually, he has played for the idea of b4, and I'm not sure if Nakamura has moved just yet, but we'll see how things proceed from here, as Carlsen may have played a slightly inferior line. Back to you, Jen and Yaz.
Thank you, Maurice. And that shows one of the human biases, which is really something good when you're starting out, which is to look at all the forcing lines.
Right.
Captures, checks. When a kid is starting out in chess, it's crucial to show them that you got to check it every time. But then sometimes it goes too far as you try to reach mastery and beyond. And
right. You're looking at the more forcing lines too much.
Yeah, trading. But this is a position we have on the board, and it looks like instead of e5, which Maurice suggested, and I did think a little bit about that move. That was an interesting choice as well. It looks like Nakamura has played d5.
An extraordinary move. I mean, if he has played the move d5, I certainly did not consider that.
I think that's a transposition to your line, though, isn't it? Kind of. Except maybe with e5 instead of with bishop g4. Because, you know what I'm saying? Maybe his idea is knight d4, e5, knight b5. D4 is good.
Something like that.
Yeah.
But D5, Maurice was just mentioning that the computer had its first choice, its second choice, its third choice, its fourth choice. I'm not sure that D5 would have been my fourth choice. Wow. Okay, let's have a look at what this move has in mind. As Maurice was just mentioning, it's clear that what White wants to do is go knight to d4 and win a pawn. How sweet it is. So the move d5 actually is designed to prevent that, in the sense that if White were to happy-go-lucky play the move knight d4, then after e5, knight takes b5, d4, one of the codependents is lost. White would be forced to sacrifice one of his pieces. And so that is the reason why.
Well, it's funny that I'm looking for ways.
There may be compensation.
Looking for ways to sacrifice with a4 and queen takes d8 and knight takes d7, but I think they're falling a little short because b4 is also hanging at the end.
Sure.
But with that pawn so close to the home run there on c6, it's like you always got to examine these things.
Right. So what Jen was talking about is, if you can get rid of that blockading pawn on c7, that pawn on c6 is sure looking like a good wide receiver ready for a touchdown.
Oh, indeed.
But okay, so this is a line that probably works out in Black's favor.
Yeah, that's kind of the idea. So it was similar to the line that you were looking at earlier with bishop g4 and d5, but here more direct. But
much more direct.
But e5 immediately, of course, was a more kind of natural response, just stopping knight to d4.
Right.
So instead, d5 immediately gives White a lot more options. So instead of knight d4, what other ways could we target the pawn? I mean, queen d3 comes to mind.
Yeah, queen d3 does, but I'm not really sure the queen's going to be very happy here on a d3. You're still spying that pawn on b5, but even if you're captured, I'll have this bishop a6 type of a move to interfere. Let's see what I could do here.
Right, but even then I could sometimes just play a4 and draw.
Mm-hmm. Well,
that wouldn't necessarily be the end of the world, that pin.
Not at all, not at all. Okay, let's see what I can do to how's this as an idea? I'm sacrificing the pawn in many variations. With the move rook e8, what I'm trying to do is to play for e5.
I kind of want to go for the other pawn, actually. You do,
exactly. You don't. No longer you're interested in grabbing this pawn, because if you were to do so, you may not find the resulting positions to your liking.
Lots of center control in it, and a big threat here of just playing the direct e4.
But
so
you're right.
So rook e1 instead seems much more natural. But then, does e5 work anyway? Is a big question. It doesn't look like it, because if you were to play e5, then after knight takes d5 here.
Yes, e4.
Now e4. So it's nice that after knight takes f6, bishop f6. Queen takes f6 is stopping bishop takes f6 will lose to just queen takes d8.
Right.
And then we get to live to tell the tale of our pawn. But instead, queen takes f6, and now no real in-between moves here, except we have queen e3, which pins the pawn
Temporarily
pins filling. Rather the pawn on e4, disallowing a pawn takes f3 for the moment.
Right.
And
let's see how we can. Maybe we can take.
So what's the tally here? We're up.
You're only up a pawn.
We're up a pawn. Okay.
But look at these two bishops. They're doing nice things in the position. I'm not satisfied with the rook on b8 for a moment, but in this case, I'm not sure that Black has sufficient compensation. Here, here, and here, and this looks better for Magnus. I like that the queen is doing good defensive work here at the moment.
Messy, and the nice thing is that c7's in take. So we'll move like bishop a6, we can play knight takes c7, and without calculating it in depth, it just seems like a too big of a pawn to give up.
Indeed.
Even if you're getting the e2 one in exchange.
Right, that's a very long-winded forcing line. So let's see if queen d3, I can't be a little bit sharper in the position from up. Now the immediate e5, knight takes e5, knight e4.
So the immediate e5, allowing knight takes e5, is one
right.
of the author's other suggestions, because as we saw, we really need to get things going as quickly as possible here with Black. But
it doesn't look like this is going to pan out at all. This is just, I was hoping that there would be, pardon me, a discovered attack against that knight on e5. This doesn't look like it's panning out for Black.
No, it looks pretty bad. Let's take a quick look at our other game before we
sure.
get a break. So we've got Kamsky-Aronian, and with good reason we've been paying more attention to this this fabulous strategic creative battle. But
battle of the leaders.
We also got Kamsky, who played the kind of rather unambitious London opening, and it seemed to Yasser earlier that Aronian had comfortably equalized. And would you say that's still the case?
I don't know. We'll play catch-up. When we left it in this position where I thought that White's intention was to maybe centralize his knight with the tempo gaining knight d2 to f3, as well as to chip away at Black's center with c4. So the move that was played was a5, and that would not have been my first choice. c4, there we go, chipping away at the center. Rook e8, also not my first choice. Takes, knight takes, a3, gosh, king g8, okay. So at this point, I'm beginning to favor White by a smidgen. Think in terms of Sicilian defense positions where you often trade your pawn on c4 for a black pawn on d5. In this structure, I do like very much these four pawns, this majority both on the king side and the center. And I have a slight preference
Me too.
For so, Gata's position here.
So fianchetto bishops turning both games into some advantage for White, and we'll see how much. But right now, we are going to take our first break, and
Lovely.
Stay with us. We're going to be getting Grandmaster Short on the air as well.